Good morning. My name is Christian Spalding. I'm an interventional cardiologist working at the European Hospital Georges Pompidou in Paris, France. And it's my pleasure to present two cases on difficult patients. One you'll see has cardiogenic shock, and the other one has had a out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. So this is a case of a 54-year-old female patient who had actually no risk factors for coronary artery disease. She has a prolonged chest pain, and she calls our emergency medical system in Paris for this chest pain approximately 2 hours after the onset of chest pain. And when the emergency medical system comes to her home, she's got good blood pressure, no clinical signs of heart failure, and they decide because of ST segment elevation in the anterior leads to bring her to a catheterization laboratory. She receives prasugrel, aspirin, low miracle weight. Unfortunately, this patient has VF during transportation. She has several shocks. And the final report before she gets to the hospital is that she has a systolic blood pressure which is starting to go down, and they've started inotropes. So the first questions that we're going to address is basically this patient was supposed to be brought to a cath lab in a hospital without cardiac surgery and without cardiac assist devices, but with an interventional cardiology lab. And this was supposed to be her destination. The closest cath lab in a hospital is with cardiac surgery and cardiac assist at 20 minutes is full. And the first available hospital with cardiac surgery and cardiac assist is 30 minutes away. So the question is, what would you do if you were the emergency medical system physician? And the answer of the emergency medical physician was to bypass the first hospital and to bring her to our institution that has cardiac surgery and cardiac assist. And basically this is because this patient had a definition of cardiogenic shock, and she would need more, first an angioplasty and maybe even more than that. So you can see on the coronary angiogram that the ostial LAD is occluded. There's a sort of a haziness on the beginning of the circumflex. One wonders if the thrombus is not actually going down to the circumflex. And this is another view of the occluded LAD, and the right coronary artery was normal. So questions again. What should you do? Should you do an immediate PCI on the left anterior descending artery? Should you put in a hemodynamic support before you do the procedure? And which medical regimen? So the answer, and probably retrospectively these were the wrong answers, PCI was performed immediately by the operator who was doing the case. And actually, when he was trying to open up the LAD with the guide wire, ventricular fibrillation occurred, requiring cardioversion, actually 12 shocks and all intubation. And that's when he called a rescue team. I was part of it. And basically, we were doing PCI during the CPR, and we finally managed to open up the LAD. So as you can see on this view, this is the LAD. We actually managed to open up part of the LAD. We opened up the proximal, the mid, but as you can see on the distal LAD, there's an ugly dissection right here with an occlusion of the distal LAD. And the question at that moment is that we have reopened up most of the LAD. Should we continue struggling to be able to open up the complete distal part of the LAD, or should we stop? So basically, the patient has been intubated and is receiving adrenaline in those days. The blood pressure has gone up to 115/95. The echocardiogram shows anterior and lateral akinesia with a 20% left ventricle ejection fraction. The RV function seems normal. And once again, because we're in a tertiary center with a cardiac surgeon, with the cardiac support. We've got the cardiac surgeon, and we have the ECMO team that has been come in. So the two questions was, first, should we continue PCI? And the decision was no. We have managed to open up the most of the LAD, and we're going to lose the distal LAD. We've done most of the job, let's say 90%. And the second question was, what should be done? Should we choose between ECMO and Impella, which is a system that manages to bring cardiac support, or should we just continue the procedure? And this is maybe the importance of a heart team discussion. Once again, we were in the cath lab with an interventional cardiology team, a cardiac surgeon, an ECMO support ECMO team, nurses who know how to use ECMO, who also know how to manage the Impella. And so we had a long discussion. And the answer, and actually it went against my decision, I was actually more in favor of implanting an ECMO, but the decisions were, the final decision was to implant an Impella. And the reasons behind this decision was, number one, the right ventricle function was normal. Impella brings left support, ECMO brings left and right heart support, but you can probably get by with Impella support rather than ECMO support when you don't have any RV failure, which was the case in this patient. The second advantage of the Impella is that the sheath is lower and that there is probably less vascular complication, and there is no venous access. So we implanted percutaneously an Impella CP. Don't forget that with the Impella, there is approximately a 7 to 10% local complication rate, so this has to be done very, very carefully. We had hemolysis, which can occur with an Impella CP, and we finally managed to reduce the flow of the Impella, which was withdrawn actually surgically with a surgical cut down because the patient was relatively obese. The patient actually, because of hemolysis, had dialysis during 2 months and progressively returned to a normal function, and 5 months after was asymptomatic with LV ejection fraction of 50% and a normal renal function. Therefore, a relatively favorable outcome. So this case demonstrates the difficulties of choosing between cardiac assist devices. Impella is easier to implant than a ECMO. It's more rapid. The sheath size is lower. It produces with the Impella CP a 3.5 to 4% to 4 liter per minute support. The advantages of the ECMO is that it produces left and right support and oxygenization, and the discussion and the choice between both should be based on a team discussion based on the clinical factors of the patient. Second case, a patient who had not a STEMI, but almost a out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. This is a very interesting male patient of 48 years old. He had family history of coronary artery disease, and he was a farmer. Actually, he was raises turkeys, and he is working as a very, very physical work. And on top of that, he adds 1 hour of running or cycling to his daily routine, runs 1 to 2 marathons per year, and was part of the Paris Marathon. And 1 kilometer from the arrival, he suddenly has a sudden cardiac arrest, and he's very lucky. He's running right beside firefighters, and he's got immediate cardiopulmonary resuscitation from bystanders. The emergency medical system arrives 5 minutes after the onset of arrest. During the Paris Marathon, we've got emergency medical systems that are approximately every 5 kilometers during the marathon. And He had a heart rate of 45 per minute, a low blood pressure. He was confused, but he was conscious. And as you can see on the electrocardiogram, he has an ST segment elevation on leads D2, D3, and VF with a chest pain. So he's actually had an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest with an ST segment elevation due probably to an inferior myocardial infarction. Inferior STEMI. So the question is what treatment should this patient receive on the field and what are the options? He received atropine and fluid challenge, probably to treat right ventricular failure. And he had our protocol for STEMI, ticagrelor, aspirin, low molecular weight heparin, and then he was sent to the cath lab that was available, which was in our hospital. On admission to the cath lab, he had no confusion, still had chest pain, no clinical signs of right or left heart failure. He still had the same electrocardiogram. So basically, we're dealing with a patient who had an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest with ST segment elevation and therefore is admitted directly into the cath lab. And he's got hypokinesia of the inferior wall and the RV seemed hypokinetic. On the coronary angiogram, this is the view of the left coronary artery. You can see that there is a very tight ostial stenosis on the LAD. There's also a tight stenosis on the first marginal branch. This is another view of the LAD where you can also see that there is a bifurcation. There are two bifurcation lesions actually on the LAD with the first and the second diagonal branch. And therefore we got a ostial and a mid LAD and we got a two bifurcation lesions, three if you include the ostial LAD. And on the right coronary artery, this is a patient that has less pain. And when we injected the right coronary artery, the pain completely disappeared with a normal ST, with a normal electrocardiogram, and the ST segment elevation had disappeared. And as you can see here, you've got a tight stenosis on the right coronary artery. So the questions is basically we got a 48-year-old MAPE patient with triple vessel disease with lesions on the proximal LAD, mid LAD, diagonal branches, marginal branch. We got a TIMI 3 flow on the lesions and we actually had a heart team discussion exactly like before. I called the surgeon and the questions were, should we send the patient immediately to surgery? Should we send the patient to surgery in a week or two? Should we perform PCI on the RCA? And then after on the other lesions? And we finally decided after discussion to perform PCI on the right coronary artery and then discuss later on to do and reevaluate the other lesions and probably do coronary artery bypass surgery. So we implanted a DES, and then we also decided later on that we would do a angiographic control after 6 months to be able to check to see if there was any restenosis and do a surgery using mammary arteries only in this very young patients. So we implanted a drug-eluting stent. And this is the result after the implantation of the stent. We weren't very happy with what we saw before and after the stent. So the patient finally ended up with a Stree stent because there was dissection after we included the second stent. But the result, as you can see, is very favorable. He had a relatively easy in-hospital follow-up with a troponin rise, an echo which returned to normal. And the plan at 6 months was to do a coronary angiogram, and if there was no restenosis on the right coronary artery, to do a planned CABG with left and right mammary artery grafts on the left coronary artery. The only problem is that this patient didn't live in Paris and that he had a negative test performed and a coronary angiogram that was performed in another center. And I got a call from a friend, an interventional cardiologist, says we got a problem because I got a negative test on this patient at one at a relatively high level and no restenosis. So what should we do? And we finally decided to bring the patient back to our center, perform FFR on the LAD, on the diagonal branch, on the marginal branch also, and all were less than 0.8. And therefore, we finally did surgery using two mammary arteries on the LAD and the two diagonal branches and also the marginal branch. One last question on this patient. This is a patient who wants to run marathons again. What is your advice? I don't have an answer to that question. The current guidelines, we followed the current guidelines, which means that we sent the patient to a rehab center where he was tested, where he got advices. And basically what we advise is that we agreed with a training program where we would have regular running without any peaks. And actually, this patient went back and started running marathons again. And what do you prefer in this patient? And do you prefer no sports or no sports? We preferred having sports. Thank you for your attention.